Well, good morning. Welcome to worship. Welcome to Western Avenue Baptist Church. It's so good to see all of you here today. It's been a good week here at the church with our church family. I hope it's been good for you all as well. And so excited to see we have some guests here with us today. And for all of our guests, our special visitors, we want to extend a special welcome to you. We want to thank you for being a part of our service here today, and we pray God's blessings upon you and your family today. And if you are a guest with us today, we would ask that you take one of those little cards that you'll find on the back of the chair in front of you. If you'll just take that and fill that out and give us information, you can drop that off at the welcome desk on your way out today. And as you drop that off, we'll also present to you a gift as our way of expressing our thanks for you being a part of our service today. But it is good to see all of you here today. A couple of things to make you aware of. Today is our final day to receive nominations for deacons for the upcoming year. So if you haven't gotten those turned in, make sure you drop those off with an usher or a staff member. Drop those off in the offering box. But today is the cutoff for that. Also, this Wednesday night in this room for Equipity University, we'll have our own Jim Pemberton speaking this week, and so we invite you to join us for that. This past week, we had Jeff Durham, and we've had a great slate of speakers this entire summer, both men and women bringing the word to us, and all those have been recorded, so if you missed one of our Wednesday nights, make sure you go to the website and check those out. Also, I want to remind you that this Thursday morning, for you men, we'll be having our third Thursday fellowship, and that'll be at 6:30 a.m. in the fellowship hall. And this month, we've got Joe Hudson as our guest speaker, so you don't want to miss that. That'll be this Thursday at 6:30 a.m. And then finally, I want to remind you that we are having the parent and youth conference, which will be on September the 24th, and that's called Stand Firm. And you can look more in your newsletter for details about some of the topics that will be presented. But that'll be a great opportunity for your parents to come and to learn how to navigate this world, as to raise up your children in the ways of the Lord. Well, let's begin this morning by going to the Apostle Paul and hear these words he has for us that we read about in Romans chapter 5, beginning with verse 6. Paul writes, "For while we were still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us that in while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." And what amazing love that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. Let's stand. Let's worship him today.
Die we glory, God who saves us, amazing love. How can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me? He was forgiven because I am forsaken. May we praise him and worship him this morning.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were.
Couple of things to draw to your attention as we go before the Lord to pray. In between the services, we've got a couple of texts. Andy got a couple of texts. One of them that we want to ask you guys to pray for is Lily Reed Messick. That's the daughter of Bradley and Anna Messick. She's about a month old, I'm guessing. She was spent a lot of time in the NICU, had several collapsed lungs, but they just took her to the hospital with RSV. So we want you to be praying for them. They got other twin girls that are older, so Bradley's with them, and then Anna's taken Lily Reed to the hospital. So please be in prayer for them as we go before the Lord now. And then also Ellen Fox, who was here for many years in the Marriage and Family Enrichment Center. Her husband, Clark, had a stroke this morning at 3:30. So he's about halfway through the critical 48 hours spot. Ellen talked with a couple of us this morning. She was glad. He recognizes her, and she told me that she was able to hear his voice this morning, which she was praising the Lord for. So as we go before the Lord, I want to ask you as God's people to pray for both of those situations, for both of those families. As I pray, you guys pray along with me. Let's go to the Lord. Jesus, we love you. We thank you so much that you love us. Without your love, Lord, we would be nowhere. And we know that you're a good God and that you're a good healer. Lord, we know that in your touch there's healing, and we pray right now that you would bring that. Lord, especially in both of these situations, Lord, we pray that for Lily Reed, that you would put your hand upon her and the doctors, and that she would get some good medicines and good care, and Lord, that you would protect her little lungs. And we pray for Bradley and Anna and Sharon and Billy and just the grandparents. We pray that you would just give them calmness, knowing that she's in good hands. Lord, and we lift up Clark Fox to you. Lord, for the next several days, Lord, I pray that you would just restore his body. Lord, that you would let the blood flow again, that you would restore his brain, his movement, restore strength on his in his hands and his feet and his side. Lord, I pray that you would, that we would trust you for this. And I pray for Ellen as she's beside him. Lord, that you would give her strength as things seem uncertain. Lord, that she would cling to you in this time. I pray that you would do this. Lord, we come before you humbly asking that you would. We praise you that, Lord, you've called us together to be a family. Lord, and when the family hurts, Lord, we hurt with the family, and we pray that we would be able to carry burdens. I know there's a lot in this room. Lord, we don't even know But you know, and I pray that for those who are struggling, Lord, that they would let it be known so we can walk alongside of them and carry the burdens together. Lord, as you've called us to do, we thank you so much for this church. I pray that you would bless us now as we hear from your word. Lord, that you would teach us, instruct us, Lord, show us the way of life. I pray as we leave this place, Lord, and go back to our jobs, and as students and teachers go back to school in the next couple weeks, Lord, I pray that you would just give them extra compassion and extra grace and boldness, and Lord, help them to stand firm as they walk into places that may be hostile to you, Lord, places that may be teaching different ways of life, different instruction, Lord, that we would walk in your way and not turn from it to the right or left. Lord, I pray for parents of students who are going back to school. I pray that you would give them strength to walk with their students through many changes, through many uncertainties as well. Lord, we thank you so much for what you're doing in this congregation, for what you're doing through your people in this congregation, as those who are overseas even right now. Lord, I pray that you would bless them, that you would keep those safe that are traveling home, those who are still there. Lord, I pray that you would give them opportunities to share your good news. Lord, I thank you for giving us the opportunity to come here together. Lord, we come together asking forgiveness for our sins, admitting that we're sinners. Lord, I pray for, Lord, I pray you forgive me for the sins this week where I've been maybe apathetic or just not walking the way that I should. I pray that we would lay those down before you, knowing that you're a good God who forgives. Lord, help us to turn, to walk in your way. Lord, help us to follow you. And I pray that as we continue to look into your word, as we sing praises to your name, Lord, that our heart, the meditations of our heart, the words from our mouth would be pleasing in your sight, O Lord. It's in your name we pray, Jesus. Amen.
I want you to stand with us and join in singing Great Are You.
You give life, you are love, you bring life.
Are you Lord? Are you
Some digital marketing experts estimate that most Americans see between 4,000 to 10,000 ads per day. I mean, that's a lot. So I mean, it might seem like a crazy number, but you start to think about it. You break down what those are. Here's some of the ads that you might see in a day. There's paid search ads. That's people that pay to have their ads on like search engines. In-app banner ads, video ads, streaming ads, social media ads, emails, digital banner ads, in-game ads, product placement in movies, TV shows, videos, billboards, commercials, if those are such a thing anymore. But the companies that are selling products work really hard to get you to look at their stuff. They have people, teams of people that work really hard to figure out how you work. There's a lot of digital companies now, especially companies that have apps. They have teams solely dedicated to basically studying human psychology, to see what makes you tick, because they want you to keep coming back to their app. They want you to keep scrolling. They want you to keep liking. They want you to keep clicking on these things. They basically want you to stay addicted to their product. News stations are good at this, too. They're good at like getting you to watch the news channel. And one of the ways they do this is now they get two people that are on alternate sides of an opinion, and they just scream at each other, right? And it's hard not to watch that. It's like watching a train wreck. You just can't stop watching people scream at each other. And we go back to it because they figured out, I think there's something about us that we have this need to know information, and we just want it. So they play on that. They come to that. And I mean, there's other things in the world that are trying to get you to look at them, right? If you have children in your house or you're around children all the time, right? Dad, look what I did. Look what I can do. Look how I can ride my bike. Look what I built. Look what I drew. Or if you get with your friends, maybe some of you have like group chats. Some teenagers, maybe you send memes like, look at this. Have you seen this? Or have you seen this video? Or you see somebody you haven't seen in a long time and they say, hey, have you watched this new TV show? Or, hey, you got to take a second and watch this YouTube video, right? You need to look at this. They stick a phone in your face and say, look at this. Have you seen this? And so everywhere we go, there's people in the world that are trying to get us to look at stuff. And I'm afraid that if we spend a ton of our time looking at all of this stuff, that we might be looking at the wrong things. And so today in Psalm 19, David is going to point out three places that we should look, three places that we should spend our time, three places that we should turn our eyes, basically. The first one is, he says, is we should look up to God's world. We should look up to God's creation. The second one is that we should look down to God's word. And then the third one, he says, we should look in to our hearts. So as we walk through Psalm 19, that's what we're going to think about, looking up, looking down, and looking in. So let's start Psalm 19, verses 1 through 6. It says this, "The heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims his handiwork. Day to day pours out speech, and night to night reveals knowledge. There is no speech, nor are there words whose voice is not heard. Their voice goes out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them he set a tent for the sun, which comes out like a bridegroom leaving his chamber, and like a strong man runs its course with joy. Its rising is from the end of the heavens, and its circuit to the end of them, and there's nothing hidden from its heat." So if you notice, in those first six verses, David uses language about creation using language. He says, the skies above declare the glory of God, or the heavens declare the glory of God, the sky above, the expanse proclaims. So he talks about that creation is talking about God and saying some things about God, but he emphasizes a little bit how it's saying those things. How is creation testifying to God? So we're going to look at some of those. We're going to look at what it's saying about God, what we can learn from creation about God, and we're going to learn from how it's talking about God. So the first verse, it says, "The heavens declare the glory of God. The sky above proclaims his handiwork." It's like David says, look up at the skies. Look how the skies are shouting about this God that created them. Look how the clouds or the sunset is proclaiming, is speaking very loudly about who God is. And we may know that feeling. You guys ever seen a sunset? Or just sometimes some beautiful, big, fluffy, white clouds on a beautiful, clear day. You just kind of get taken in, and you can't help but look. And probably my first instinct to some of y'all is like, I gotta get a picture of this to, like, capture this moment. And then you go back and look at the picture, and it never lives up to the real thing. And so creation, the skies are just all the time declaring very loud about who God is, this creator. It's like they're saying, look at us, look at this, look at what God has done. And each day there's a new sunset, there's a new sunrise. It's like there's just creativity all the time. God is is a creative creator. And then at night, right, it's the same thing. The skies still declare the glory of God. The sun goes down and the stars start to come out, and the moon starts to come out. And they speak loudly about who God is. It's an emphatic declaration. And verse 2 says, day to day pours out speech, night to night reveals knowledge. So it's like creation is speaking very loud about who God is, and it's unstoppable. Like, you can never stop creation from speaking about God. It's irrepressible. Day to day pours out speech. Like, if you left the water running in your kitchen sink, eventually it would, like, start to run over, right? This is, like, creation is running over, speaking about God. And then the sun goes down, it's nighttime, and the night's like, hey, we got some stuff to show you too, right? The night reveals knowledge. I mean, I think the nighttime is as full of life as the daytime. It's amazing, like, the sounds of the night. You know, one of the things I love about being here or summertime is cicadas. I just love the sound. I mean, it's just like there's life that's out there. Sometimes that can be scary because you don't know what that life is. But the night reveals more knowledge about the God is the creator. The night has more to show. Then verse 3, he goes on. He says, there's no speech, nor are there words whose voice is not heard. The New International Version says it this way. It says, they have no speech, speaking of creation or the skies. They have no speech. They use no words. No sound is heard from them. And David recognizes, as probably you do too, that the sun doesn't use language like I'm talking to you now, or the trees don't talk, but they speak. They still speak. They still talk. They still tell things about God. And so David goes on in verse 4. He says, they speak loudly, they speak clearly, they speak, it's unstoppable. And in verse 4, what creation is saying about God goes everywhere. Goes to the ends of the earth, throughout all the earth. Their words go to the end of the world. This loud, clear, unstoppable speech goes everywhere. And there's nowhere in all of creation that can escape the testimony of creation about the Creator. Nowhere. And I think it's interesting because as Christians, we're called to take God's word to the ends of the world, right? But creation has already beat us there. It's already proclaiming who God is. And I think it's really cool that we get to experience God's creation, that we can walk outside of these walls and look at the trees or spend some time looking at a moth or something small like that, or something grand like a star that's millions of miles away. I mean, we can look at oceans and lakes and be amazed, and we know that all of it declares God's glory. Next, he moves into a few verses about the sun, which is just, I mean, that's just one of the things about God's creation. And the sun is pretty amazing, right? He says this about him. He says, in them he set a tent for the sun, which comes out like a bridegroom leaving his chamber, like a strong man runs its course with joy. Its rising is from the end of the heavens, and its circuit to the end of them. There's nothing hidden from its heat. In some of the surrounding cultures around Israel at this time, they would have worshipped the sun. Mesopotamians, the Egyptians, they worshipped the sun god. But the Israelites, and David here especially, knows that God is in control of the sun. The sun is not the god, but there is one who is in control of this one, like an enthusiastic warrior that runs its course every day. He talks about the consistency of the sun coming up, going down. And he even says that God sets a tent, like God makes a place for the sun to sleep. So God is in control. So yes, while the sun is very powerful and we can see it and know that there would be no life on this earth without the sun, there would be no sun without God. And so God is much more powerful. And David is saying that. Look at the sun. Look at the skies. Look how they declare God's glory. Look how they declare God's honor. Look at the works of his hands. See that it talks about him very emphatically. See that it's loud. See that it's unstoppable in how it speaks about God. See that the words of creation about God go everywhere. And yet, we know all of those things, but the testimony of creation is pretty limited, right? There's only certain things that you can know about God through creation. You can't know everything. Like, you can know that he is a creator. There is a creator God behind all of this. You can know that he's powerful. Just stand outside in the middle of a thunderstorm. You can know that he's magnificent. You can know that he's a God who loves life. Just look at the diversity of life that is on this planet. You can know that he is a creative God, not only in quality, but also in quantity. He just can't help but create. Right? Think about in each snowfall, how many millions, billions, I don't even know, number of masterpieces that just seemingly get thrown away in each snowflake. So he said, God, we can know this about God, but we're still limited. Because what happens sometimes, I think, is that we take this advice, we go out and we look into creation, we spend time there, and you can't help but be amazed at how creation is. You can't help but look at this and go, wow, this is pretty incredible. And then the temptation for us as humans becomes to worship the creation over the creator. And that's what Paul talks about in Romans chapter 1. In verse 18 to 23, he says, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. For what can be known about God is plain to them, because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world and the things that have been made. So they're without excuse. For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him, but they became futile in their thinking, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds and animals and creeping things." And it wasn't only a temptation for the people in the Bible. It's a temptation today. You may know people or have conversations with people that kind of go like this. You know, when I get out in nature, this is where I really commune with God. You know, I don't go to church on Sunday morning because getting out here and catching some waves, that's my church. Right? That falls short. Now, it's not wrong. I mean, it's good for us as Christians to get outside, to go hike, to go explore, to go rock climbing, to go do all of these things. But I think God has made us for this earth and for this creation. But when that talk starts to come out of your mouth, I think you're in the wrong place, because that talk falls short. Because you can only know a few things about God, his power, his divine, some of his divine attributes. But God's, the way he reveals himself in nature is just not enough. It's not enough to get the full picture about who God is. And so David says, after you look up into God's world and you see how amazing God is and you hear how it talks about him very emphatically and how it goes to the ends of the earth, after you do that, after you look up, you need to look down. And you need to look at God's word. And you need to see how God reveals himself to us in his word. You need to see the testimony of his word. And he talks about this in verses 7 through 11. And just as we read through this, notice there's a slight little change. Right? Because in verse 1, he says, "The heavens declare the glory of God." Right? God, that's one word in Hebrew. It's El, or Elohim, kind of short for Elohim. Right? A very almost generic, I don't want to, this is, it's kind of a generic word for God, just God. Right? But then in verse 7 through 11, he uses another word for God. And if you look in your Bibles real quick, if you glance down there, he says it about six times. You can see that the word Lord is written in all capital letters. And whenever you see that in an English translation, that is where they've translated the name for God, Yahweh, the personal name for God, the name that God gave Moses when he was at Mount Sinai, right? It's the covenant name of God, the way that he's revealed himself through his promises and his word to his people Israel. So notice that. I don't think it's unintentional. I think you can only learn that there is a God. You can learn about God from nature, but you can learn about Yahweh from his word. So let's read 7 through 11. It says, "The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. And the precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The rules of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and drippings of honeycomb. Moreover, by them is your servant warned. In keeping them, there's great reward." And I don't know, sometimes if you do like word association, some of those words that we just read, like law or precepts or rules or commandments, they sometimes carry like a negative connotation, right? Laws or rules always feel like something maybe, I mean, some of you guys are getting ready to go back to school and the teacher for a long time will spend time going over the rules. Or if you go with us on a trip or somewhere, we spend a long time going through the rules. And you might think to yourself, that's really restrictive. Why is this rule in this place, right? But the rules of the Lord, the law of the Lord, while we look at them and may associate them with something negative, David always associates them with something very positive, very life-giving. The word there, law, is the word Torah, which can also mean instruction, the teaching, the law of the Lord. He says, you could say it this way, the instruction of the Lord is perfect, right? God is a good teacher. The instruction of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul, or restoring one's life, right? God's word makes dead things come back to life. That's what it does. His word, his law, his testimony is pure. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. God's word gives wisdom. And we know that wisdom is biblically the ability to make good decisions according to God's word. So good decisions save lives. So it's life-giving. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. God's word makes your heart glad. Proverbs tells us that the heart, a joyful heart is good medicine, right? And medicine is there to restore and to bring life. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. So God's word brings light. If you walk around in the morning, sometimes I get up early before anybody's up and I don't want to turn on any lights, but I need light to see because there might be little Legos, things that are hazards and traps that are just waiting to jump up and grab me. And so the word of the Lord is light, and it brings to light. It makes us be able to see what is happening. That's what David is saying. So the goodness of the word is that you can see and that your eyes are bright, not dim and dull. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. That's the reverence that he lays down, the reverence that he requires lasts forever. And the rules of the Lord are true and righteous. They're good. And he says they're more to be desired than fine gold and honey. The words of God are always something good, always associated with something good. And so he goes on in verse 11. He says, "By them your servant is warned. Moreover, by them your servant is warned," that the word of the Lord gives you a warning to stay away from certain things. Just like if you have a child that really likes to play in the street, or that really likes to get around transformer boxes or electrical wires as they hang down, you want to give them a warning, stay away from this. And that warning is there not to keep them from having fun, but to keep them alive. And that's like God's word is for us, to keep us, to give us good life. So your servant is warned by them. And then the last part of verse 11, he says, in keeping them, there's a great reward. That there's good to follow. It's kind of like what the psalmist talks about in Psalm chapter 1, that He said, blessed is the man who doesn't walk or sit in the seat of the scoffers, the way of sinners, those kind of things. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He thinks about God's word day and night. The image that's used in Psalm 1 is that this man who delights in the law of the Lord and meditates in it is like a tree, a strong tree planted by streams of water that bears fruit in season. It's season, it bears fruit. It's like it always has fruit. It says this leaf never withers. It's always in season. It's always alive. And then he says everything he does prospers. Right? He's successful. Maybe not in the eyes of the world or the way we want to be successful, but this is a person, a man or a woman, who's living a good life, who's strongly connected to the word that prospers. And so we see this, that God's word is there to keep us alive, right? It's life-giving. It gives wisdom. It's all of these good things. It enlivens our eyes. It lasts forever. But just like the temptation, sometimes when we go outside and we look at God's world and we're tempted to worship creation over creator, right? We have that temptation. Sometimes I think with the Bible, what can happen or what we can do is we look at this, and one, we might say, yeah, I believe that the law of the Lord is life-giving, and I believe that it can restore my soul. I believe that I should follow its ways, and then we don't. Like, our lives don't line up with what we say we believe. Like, that can be a temptation. Or you can look at this, and you go, you know, that was probably all right and good when David wrote that, you know, but I feel like some of these things are the law of the Lord, some of the things that we learn from the scripture are pretty restrictive. And, you know, this is the 21st century now, and, you know, surely we're past all of this. Surely we've progressed as a people far enough that there's some good in here, how to treat people. You know, I like some of the words that Jesus says, or I like some of the Psalms or some of the Proverbs, but some of this stuff seems antiquated in our progressive society or 21st century. And so I think that can be a temptation. Because there's a world of people outside, right, who want, just like I said, they want you to look at what they're teaching. They'll gladly teach you. They want you to look at their instruction. They want you to look away from this word. And slowly but surely, they will guide you away, or you'll start to drift away from the word, from being connected to the word, from believing the word. Because we call them, if you ever look at YouTube or TikTok or Instagram, there's people, like, the word for those people are influencers, right? Their main job is to influence you, mostly to buy products, right? They get paid to do that. But they want to influence your thoughts. They want to get your eyes to look at what they're selling. And then really, when they have your eyes, they have your heart. And so these influencers or personalities, they may promise good things, things that seem very life-giving, like beauty or money or fame or success, right? All you have to do is buy this product. And it's not just, and I'm not ganging up on social media. I don't want you to hear me that. Because I mean, social media can be good. We can use that in a good way. But it's what happens when people try to sell products. I mean, it's been happening forever, right? With infomercials and, right, just buy this for easy payments of $19.99, or you can download all of my lectures for $100 and you too can be successful like I am. So there are people in this world, that the world wants to disciple you. And you're going to be, either you can choose to be discipled by Jesus and by the word of God, or you're going to choose to be discipled by the world. Whether that's through social media, whether that's through news that you watch, or TV shows that you watch, they are gladly teaching things that look like they offer life. They look like they're good for you. They look like this will make you have a more happy, a more meaningful, a more successful life. But I think the fruit of the world, the fruit that the world offers, may look desirable, just like the fruit of the garden looked desirable, looked good to the eye, and looked good for fruit to Adam and Eve in the garden. The fruit of the world might look desirable, but once you eat of it, it's bitter because it's deceptive. And so that's why David is saying, like, there's nothing better, there's nothing that gives life like the Word of God. God's Word is always better than anything that the world can offer. And because, right, as we look at it, it's not always easy. It's not always easy to read God's law, and when it says live like one way that's against the world, it's hard to follow sometimes. It's hard to do that, but it's always good. It's always better. And as we keep reading this word, we keep learning more about this God who loves us. We learn way more about God's character from his word, how he reveals himself in the word, than we do if we go outside and look at creation. We learn things about his faithfulness. We learn things about his loving kindness. We learn things about how he's patient through the stories that we read, the Israelites, the disciples. We learn that he's a compassionate God. We learn a lot about who he's like because we read of Jesus' life. We learn that he's gracious, that he's generous, that he's sacrificial. That's the testimony that the word gives us about who he is. So David said, when you look up at God's world, you see his creation, you hear the loud, unstoppable, constant, all-reaching testimony about God. Then you look down at God's word, and you see that his instruction, his law, the testimony that's revealed in his word gives life, that it makes people wise. It gives them the best life that they can ever have. It revives. It's more desirable than any gold, any honey, anything sweet, or any kind of money. But what this word does also is it brings light. And just like the sun is an amazing creation that brings light to God's creation, and as we look at God's creation, we can see God. The word brings light. But what the word shines light on, one of the things I think is it shines lights into our heart. It shines a light into our heart, and it shows us our sin. It shows us where we don't line up with this instruction. It shows us where we do fall short. And then by seeing our sin, we start to see that we need somebody to save us from the sin. We need a redeemer. And as we continue to read God's word, we see that redeemer is Jesus. So the third thing he says is look up at God's world, look down at God's word, then look into your heart. David realizes that his heart is full of sin, and he needs to turn to God to remedy that, to get rid of that sin. So verse 12 to 14, he says, "Who can discern his errors? Declare me innocent from hidden faults. Keep back your servant also from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me. Then I shall be blameless and innocent of great transgression. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer." So he starts off in verse 12. He says, "Who can discern his errors? Declare me innocent from hidden faults." What are hidden faults? I mean, David's saying he knows that he has sin inside him. Who can discern that? The answer is only the Lord. Those hidden faults, that we all have those hidden faults. Those are sins that we have that sometimes we don't see. We might call them blind spots. Some people call them blind spots. Some people, we excuse them, those hidden sins. Sometimes we excuse them because personality, right? Or that's just part of my personality. That's just part of how I was brought up. That's just the part of the country that I'm from. Sometimes we can excuse sins in our life. But there's never, personality or upbringing or where you're from is never an excuse to sin. And I think David is saying we all have these areas of sin in our life that we can't see. And what we need to do is look in the Word and to see those and ask God to get rid of those. Right? Declare me innocent. I need to be declared innocent from hidden faults. That's one. David sees his need for innocence. He needs to be forgiven. Verse 13, he says, "Keep back your servant also from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me." He sees that he not only has hidden sins, but he has intentional sins. This blatant rebellion. There's things in our life, you can think of them in your own life, where you know it's wrong. Something you do, you know it's wrong, but you continue to do it again and again. And those sins are just as hard to get rid of as those unintentional, as those unintentional sins, those hidden faults, right? The things that maybe we've developed habits for years and years and years and years, and we know it's going to take a lot of work and a lot of discipline, maybe pain, maybe struggle. There may be some people that you have to apologize to. There may be some secret pleasures that you have to not have anymore. You might have to admit that you're not always right, or just come out and admit that you're wrong, right? Those are things that are hard to do, and we can't do them on our own. And I think that's what David is showing. Like, David is crying out to the Lord. He sees these things. He knows these things are there because he's seen in his heart, because the light of the word has shined in his heart and has shown him where he's wrong. And he says, God, I need you. I need your forgiveness. I need you to declare me innocent. And I need you to not let them rule over me. He says, let them not have dominion over me. He's basically calling out. He's like, I need forgiveness from sins, and I need power over sin. I need sin not to rule me. I need a better master. And as we continue to read through the Bible, if you look down into the Word, you get to the New Testament and you see we finally get to Jesus. And Jesus is that one who, through his blood shed on the cross, can declare you innocent from those sins. He can give you forgiveness, right? He was raised from the dead and gives us new life. And then he left and sent his Spirit. And he tells us that the Spirit gives us power, right? That we have power now to say no to sin. Jesus is the one that we need. And David is saying we need to cry out to our Lord, our rock and our Redeemer. That's what he says in verse 14. He says, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my Redeemer. He says, I need you to declare me innocent. I need you to help me rule, help me to rule over sin and not sin to rule over me. And this prayer at the end of this incredible verse, or this incredible chapter, this incredible psalm, is such a short prayer and a very meaningful prayer. I think it helps to wrap up what David is trying to say in this poem. And I would encourage you to memorize it. Maybe some of you do. Maybe this is just the way you begin your day. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my Redeemer. Maybe that's how, if it's not, maybe that's a prayer that you might need to take with you at your job when things seem stressful, when those hidden sins want to come out. Maybe you can turn to God and realize that you need him. So he prays these that his words would be pleasing in the sight of God, and that the meditations of his heart would be pleasing and acceptable in God's sight. And so it's interesting, that little phrase at the end, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart would be acceptable in your sight. Right, we've talked about looking at three things, right? We talked about looking at God's world. We talked about looking at God's word. We talked about looking into our hearts. And now, David says that we're the ones that is being looked at. May the words of my mouth and meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, in God's sight. Have you ever think to yourself, like, when God looks at you, what does he see? Or what are your words speaking about God? Right? We know the testimony of the world is speaking about God. The testimony of the word is speaking about God. But what are we speaking about God? And David's prayer is that his words and his heart meditations would be pleasing to God. You know, I mean, I got to look at this and ask, like, what is, as I think through this, like, how do we speak words that are pleasing to God? How do we meditate on things in our heart? What are those things that are pleasing to God? That's the question I ask. And I think it may be this, that the testimony of creation, how it talks about God, how it speaks about God, that's pleasing to God. And the testimony of the Word, how the Word speaks about God, how the Word talks about God, that's pleasing to God. And so our prayer should be that our words and our heart meditations would line up with both of those things. So the testimony of creation is loud. When creation talks about God, the words that creation uses are loud. They declare it. They shout it. Those words are unstoppable. Those words go everywhere. Those words are consistent. But don't you want your words about God to be like that, to be loud, to be consistent, to go to the ends of the world like Jesus commanded us to take them? Don't you want them to be unstoppable, pouring forth day after day? I know I do. But I think the only way that our words are pleasing to God is if we look up at we take time each day to look up at His world, to look at His creation, be reminded of who He is, that we look into His word, that we learn about Him by looking into His word, that we look into our own hearts and we ask, like, what are the sins, what are the faults that I have in my heart? And then the last thing we have to do, what David did, is he clung really tightly to God, to Jesus, our rock and our Redeemer. I think the way that our words and our meditations are pleasing to God, if they line up with the testimony of His word, right? The testimony of His word that we saw is true, it's life-giving. It gives wisdom. Don't you want the words that you speak about God to be true, to be life-giving and not degrading and tearing down, but used for building up one another? I think the only way that our words and our meditations are pleasing to God in that way is that if we look up to God's world, we hear God's creation telling about who He is. We look down to God's word. We hear His word telling us about who He is. We look into our hearts. We realize where our sins are, where our faults are. And then we cling as tightly as we can to Jesus, our rock and our Redeemer. Because He's the firm foundation. Jesus alone is the firm foundation that we must build our life on. He's the rescuer. He's the rock, He's the foundation, He's the rescuer, the Redeemer who calls us to follow Him. So in about 3 minutes, maybe less, when we walk out of this room and the world starts to fight again for your eyes, the world starts to fight for your attention, remember to look every day. You can start today as soon as you walk outside. Look up at God's world. Be amazed at who He is. Listen to creation speak. Spend some time there. Then look down at God's word. Read it. Know it. Memorize it. Live it. Follow it. Walk in it. It's life-giving. It's good. It's true. It's pure. It's right. Then take some time to look into your own heart. Pray that God would reveal your hidden sins, your blatant rebellion. Pray that God would be your master and that He would give you power to rule over sin, not to let sin rule you. Repent of any of those sins that He shows you. Follow Jesus every day. I think do these things, look up, look down, look in, so that when God looks at you, the words that you say, the things that you meditate on in your heart will be acceptable in His sight as you cling as tightly as you can to Jesus, our rock and our Redeemer. Jesus, we praise You. We thank You for loving us. We thank You for being our solid foundation, our rescuer, a good Lord, a good shepherd, a master who leads. I pray that You would help us to be amazed by You as we look at Your world. Help us to be overwhelmed by You as we look at Your word. Lord, help us to get rid of sin as we look into our hearts, Lord, through Your power, Lord, and as we walk before You. Help us, our words and the meditations of our heart, to be pleasing in Your sight. It's in Your name we pray, Jesus. Amen.